Welcome to Scottsdale Christian Church. Please stand and worship our Lord with us.
Thank you. Thanksgiving? Do you have a good one? Yeah. Just want to say to you that if you are new here with us, we want to welcome you here to Scottsdale Christian Church. Great to have you with us.
Thank you.
God, you have given us so much to be grateful for, and we are thankful in our spirits and our hearts. Help us to set apart Christ as Lord, to see that even though he came as a baby, he was God in the flesh, and he grew and he lived and he died for us, but he rose again, and we celebrate not only his birth but his resurrection, and we await for him to come again. God, I pray that each and every day we live with an attitude of thankfulness to you. The only reason there is good in this world is because of you. God, help us to see that we desperately need you, and we have a world that desperately needs you. And even though we may not understand your ways, we may not always understand what path you are leading us on, God, we trust you. Help that to be the cry of our hearts, that we trust you. Whether we see where we're going, whether we're lost on our way, we know you are good and faithful, and you are our Father. God, we come to you bringing the troubles that this world has, and we lay them at your feet because you are the only hope. And I pray that in this season, there will be a time that we can love and we can share the message of Christ. We can share the message of hope to a lost and dying world. God, be with us in our griefs, be with us in our joys, and may we always live for you until that day when Jesus comes again. We pray all these things in his holy name. Amen.
Amen.
Almighty God, we lift you. the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever. Forevermore, you are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever. Forevermore, you are victorious. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that
Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Please be seated.
Well, it's good to see you guys here this morning. We're finishing up a series right now called I Have a Problem with God. And probably the biggest problem we have right now is our bellies are too full and staying awake may be an issue. But when we're talking about God, there's a lot of people that have a problem with God. There's people that have issues with who he is or what he does. And probably one of the biggest things that people struggle with is the idea of how could a loving God send people to hell? And so I want to deal with that this morning for you, not only so you know what's going on, but also so as you come into contact with people, you can see what the Bible says about this subject, because it's a really hard subject. And people will say, you know, something like this, how could a loving God send people to hell? But love is only one of God's attributes. You see, beyond being loving, God is also holy, and he's also just. God is a holy and just God. And God is holy. What that means is that God is righteous. He's good. And not only is he good and righteous, but he also has expectations. He has expectations that we be good, that we be righteous, that we be holy. When we don't live up to his standards, then we have to pay the price. In Hebrews chapter 10, verse 30 and 31, it says this, the Lord will judge his people. It is a dreadful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. See, God is just means that he is going to judge every one of us fairly. He's going to judge us for the good things that we've done and the bad things that we've done. And it is a just judgment. It's always going to be right. The problem that most of us have is we tend to look at all the good things that we've done and go, oh my goodness, I may have done something wrong once, like when I was six, but all the good things I've done since then, they far outweigh that. But that's not the way that God set things up. Imagine this. Imagine if you're on the way to church this morning and you're doing 90 down McDowell Road. Cop pulls you over and says, man, I've got to give you a ticket. You know, you're doing 90 in a 45, and you say, well, wait a minute. You don't understand. I'm going to church this morning. Not only am I going to church this morning, but on the way here, you know, the guys that asked for money on the corners, I gave one of those guys some money. And on the reason I'm speeding is because I stopped to help this old lady across the street, and that's why I'm speeding, so I'm not late to church. And the cop says, well, in that case, all right, let me tear this ticket up. That's not at all what he says. He says, I don't care all the good stuff you've done. You are still a lawbreaker. You've broken the law, and because you've broken the law, you have to pay the price. God is holy. He expects us to be holy and righteous. And when we break his law, then we're due for the justice under his system. Because of God's justice, there's a place of reward for his followers, but there's also a place of punishment. You see, God designed hell, and God designed hell for the devil. When you're reading through your Bible, you're going to come across the word hell in there in a few different places. And most of the time it's translated hell, but there's a few different words there. Number one is Hades. That's where all the dead people would go. There's Tartarus, which is a prison for fallen angels. There's Sheol in the Old Testament, which is a place of suffering. There's Gehenna in the New Testament, which is a place of suffering. Hell is described throughout the Bible as a place, as a lake of burning sulfur, as a place of fire and darkness, as a place of weeping and gnashing of teeth. So hell is a real place described throughout the Bible, but you need to understand this. God did not design hell for people. He created it for the devil. See, when Satan and a third of his angels rebelled against God, they were cast out of heaven. Some are free to roam the earth, but some are now being held in Tartarus. They will eventually be thrown into the lake of burning sulfur that Revelation tells us about. Jesus tried to make this clear in Matthew 25 when he was talking kind of about the end times. He says this to talking about people. He will say to those on his left, depart from me, you who are cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. God designed hell as a place of punishment for Satan and his angels. And so God is holy and just, and he's a righteous judge. He's not going to take bribes to get people, you know, whatever. But he designed hell for the devil and his angels. But at the same time, God punishes the wicked. So we're going to look at a story that Jesus told. If you have a Bible this morning, I want you to turn to Luke chapter 16. If you don't have a Bible, there should be one in the chairs in front of you. It's page 730. You can look it on your phone or tablet if you have like the U version of the Bible. If you have your own Bible with you this morning, Luke is the Matthew, Mark, Luke, the third book of the New Testament, right before the book of John. As you're looking that up, I'll just tell you this. The story I'm going to tell you, there's some controversy whether it's a parable or a story, like a real life story. Jesus told parables all the time. I believe this is a real life story for two reasons. Number one, Jesus uses proper names of people in this. When Jesus is telling parables, a lot of times he just says generically, but he's talking about proper names of people here. And also, it just nowhere does it say that this is a parable. Most of the time when you see Jesus teaching in parables, it says Jesus told him another parable. Well, it doesn't say that with this. It just says that Jesus told him this story in Luke chapter 16, and I'm going to start reading with verse 19. Jesus says this: "There was a rich man who was dressed in purple and fine linen and lived in luxury every day. At his gate was laid a beggar named Lazarus, covered with sores and longing to eat what fell from the rich man's table. Even the dogs came and licked his sores. The time came when the beggar died, and the angels carried him to Abraham's side." That's a picture of being in paradise, being in heaven. "The rich man also died and was buried. In Hades, where he was in torment, he looked up and saw Abraham far away with Lazarus by his side. So he called to him, 'Father Abraham, have pity on me and send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, because I am in agony in this fire.' But Abraham replied, 'Son, remember that in your lifetime you received your good things, while Lazarus received bad things. But now he is comforted here, and you are in agony. And besides all this, between us and you, a great chasm has been set in place, so that those who want to go from here to you cannot, nor can anyone cross over from there to us.' He answered, 'Then I beg you, Father, send Lazarus to my family, for I have five brothers. Let him warn them, so that they will not also come to this place of torment.' Abraham replied, 'They have Moses and the prophets. Let them listen to them.' 'No, Father Abraham,' he said, 'but if someone from the dead goes to them, they'll repent.' He said to him, 'If they do not listen to Moses and the prophets, they will not be convinced, even if someone rises from the dead.'" So a lot of stuff there. I'm going to cover as much as I can this morning. The first thing we need to see is that God punishes the wicked. God punishes the wicked. In verse 23 and 24, he said, "In Hades, where he was in torment, he looked up and saw Abraham far away. So he called to him, 'Father Abraham, have pity on me and send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, because I'm in agony in this place.'" The rich man was punished because he was self-seeking instead of God-seeking. He's not punished because he was wealthy. He was punished because he had a lack of compassion for those in need. He didn't follow God. He knew the condition of this beggar. This beggar was put out in front of his gates every day. He was out there every day begging. The rich man even knew his name. He knew his name was Lazarus. He knew about this guy. And even though he knew this guy, knew his name, he did nothing to help. You could see his self-seekingness. Even when he's in torment, what's his first thing? "Give me comfort. Give me comfort." "Well, that's not possible." "Well, then take care of my family." You know, not anyone else out there, but just him and his family. Jesus was talking about people who continued to live for themselves, but didn't live for God. In Matthew 25, 46, Jesus says this. Says they will go away to eternal punishment, but the righteous to eternal life. People that don't follow God are going to be going to eternal punishment because they refuse to seek after God. Like I said earlier, God is holy. And when a holy God comes into contact with sin, then there's wrath. Paul described it as this: those who are self-seeking, reject the truth, and follow evil, there's going to be wrath and anger. God is love, yes, but he's also a God of wrath and anger because of his holiness. See, a lot of times we think, well, that's just not me. But when we are self-seeking instead of God-seeking, then there's going to be wrath. That's what Paul says. When we reject the truth instead of believing that there's a God, there will be wrath. When we follow evil instead of following God, there's going to be wrath. And people will say so many times, well, I'm so glad I don't do that. I'm glad I don't do those things. But when we're more concerned about our comfort and priorities than we are about seeking God, we fall in that same category. When we don't do what the Bible says, we're rejecting the truth. When we lie and cheat and steal and gossip and diminish other people, we're following evil. And God punishes the wicked. We also need to learn this about hell. God doesn't send people to hell, but people choose hell when they choose to reject God. People choose hell when they choose to reject God. See, this rich man in this story, he had all kinds of opportunities to know God and to follow God. He had, first of all, creation, the same creation that we have. Second of all, he had conscience. He had this internal thing that God puts inside of us to know right from wrong. Abraham told the rich man, they have the scriptures. He had Moses and the prophets. He had the Old Testament scriptures. And beyond those things, he even had the testimony of Lazarus. When he was in torment, he's like, hey, have Lazarus go and tell my brothers. Apparently, Lazarus had told him how to escape from hell, but he had rejected that in some place. So the rich man had all these opportunities to know about God. He had all these opportunities to follow God. See, the Jewish people had all kinds of laws about how to treat the poor. And this rich man knew those laws. There are laws in the Old Testament, like from Proverbs 14, that says, he who despises his neighbor sins, but blessed is he who is kind to the needy. That was a part of the Jewish culture. If you see people in need and don't do something about it, that's a sin. In Leviticus 19, it said for those that have vineyards, it says, don't go over your vineyard a second time or pick up the grapes that have fallen, but leave some behind for the poor. So if you have a vineyard, you've done all the work to plant the seeds and to get the weeds out and to water and to fertilize it and to grow the thing, to keep the animals out and all those things to make the vineyard go. And you go through and you harvest your vineyard, you clear out all the grapes. They may not all be ripe right now. But for the Jewish people, they're supposed to go through and harvest once. And then for the grapes that ripen later, leave those so the poor people can come through and they can harvest some of those things. It was a basic way to take care of the poor people. And then there's this proverb, which fits incredibly well with this rich man. It says this: if a man shuts his ears to the cry of the poor, he too will cry out and not be answered. That's an incredible fitting thing for this rich man. If he shut your ears to the cry of the poor, he too will cry out and not be answered. That's exactly what happened to this guy. But you know what? Not only did that rich man have the opportunities to know God and to follow God, we have those same opportunities today. We all have God's creation. We all have God's conscience inside of us. We have the scriptures. We have the Old Testament scriptures and we have the New Testament scriptures. We have the testimony of followers of Jesus. In this room, there's a whole lot of people that could tell you, man, you need to follow God because I do, and this is what God has done in my life. There's a testimony of a whole lot of believers in here. And beyond all those things, we also have the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We have the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We're getting ready in the month of December to celebrate the birth of Jesus, and that's a great thing. Celebrating the birth of Jesus, that's what we need to remember during the Christmas season. But Jesus' birth is not nearly as important as his death and his resurrection. because his death and his resurrection lets us know that he is stronger than death. And if you're going to trust your eternity with someone, don't you want to trust to the guy who died and beat death? I mean, that's the guy I want to follow. That's the guy that I want to trust. But despite all these opportunities, people still reject Jesus. People still reject him. In Matthew 23, 37, Jesus is looking over the city of Jerusalem. And as he's looking over the city of Jerusalem, he says this. He says, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, how you who kill the prophets and stone those sent to you, how often have I longed to gather your children as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but you were not willing. Jesus looks at Jerusalem and says, I'm just torn in compassion. How many times have I just wanted to just come and just gather you around and just hold on to you? How many times have I just wanted to bring you closer to God, but you weren't willing? If people don't want anything to do with Jesus, he honors that choice. He's not going to force you into a relationship with him. He's not going to force you into eternity with him. If you can't stand to be with Jesus right now, what in the world makes you think that you want to be with him forever? C.S. Lewis said it like this. There are only two kinds of people in the end. Those who say to God, thy will be done. And those to whom God says in the end, thy will be done. All that are in hell choose it. I was researching and reading through some of this stuff, and I saw an interview with an atheist this week on a video. And there was a call-in radio station, and this lady calls in and says, you know, choose hell. And the guy says, well, I don't choose hell. I don't believe in God, but I don't choose hell. Right now, I'm saying I choose not to go to hell. All right. He didn't get it. People choose hell when they choose to reject Jesus Christ. It's not, I want this part of God and that part of God and all the good stuff that I think that God may offer me in the future. If you're choosing God, if you're choosing Jesus Christ, you're choosing the whole package. Yes, you're choosing to escape hell. You're choosing to go to heaven. You're also choosing his lordship on this earth right now. And his lordship means that he's your boss. And if you're choosing heaven, that's great. If you choose not to go to hell, that's great. But you also have to choose the whole thing, choosing to accept Christ as your Savior, make him the boss of your life. That means decisions that you make, you run through his word first. If as I'm about to choose this, what does God's word say about these choices? And people want to choose the heaven part, but they don't want to choose living for God now. And that's what happens. God doesn't send people to hell. People choose hell when they choose to reject God, choose to reject his word, choose to reject his lifestyle. Hell is a reality. It's a sad and it's an awful reality. It's not at all what God wants for people. The whole reason Jesus hasn't returned is he's waiting for people to repent and turn to him. He wants heaven full of people. And God has provided the way to escape hell. Apparently, Lazarus knew the way. As you're reading through this story here in Luke, Lazarus knew the way. And apparently, he had talked to this rich man at some point. For us today, Jesus shared the way that we can escape hell. In John chapter 3, there's a man, a teacher, who came to Jesus at night. His name was Nicodemus. And Nicodemus saw the things that Jesus was teaching, and he was trying to understand a lot of these things. He was trying to understand them better. And so he has a conversation with Jesus, and this is where one of the most famous verses in the Bible comes from, is this conversation, John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life. A little bit later in the conversation, in John 3:36, Jesus says this, whoever believes in the Son has eternal life, but whoever rejects the Son will not see life, for God's wrath remains on them. See, if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior, then you're in a place of wrath. You're in a place where God's wrath is on you. And the way to escape that wrath, pretty simple. Believing in Jesus Christ. And remember, for the Jewish people, believing didn't mean just, oh yeah, I think Jesus was there. Believing in him meant believing and trusting in him with your eternal destiny. Believing him means following him today in everything that you know about him. That's what believing in him means. But if you want to escape hell, Jesus says, it's pretty simple. The stuff's already been done. 2,000 years ago, Jesus died on the cross for all the things that you've done wrong and all the things that I've done wrong. He died for all those things. So the gate has been opened. You just got to go through. If you believe in the Son, you'll have eternal life. And the issue that people have with following Jesus and letting him be the boss is they think if I follow Jesus, he's going to take all the fun out of life. And that's exactly not true. He's going to say, yeah, some of the things that you're doing now, you probably should stop because they seem really fun and they're promoted on TV and the movies as being really cool. But you know what an empty lifestyle that really is. You know when you wake up the next day, that you have things like regret and shame and guilt. And Jesus says, that's not the way I designed it. That's not the way I want you to live. Jesus says, I have an abundant life for you. I have a life that will give you freedom from all those things. A life that has meaning and purpose. Not just in the future in heaven, but on this earth. You don't have to be a slave to those sinful habits. You can have love in your life. You can have meaning in your life. You can have an intimacy with the God of the universe. And what Jesus offers far outweighs all the stuff that we used to live for. And so God said, you know, hell is a real place and people are going there, but he is desperate. He is desperate to get you into a relationship with him so that he can spend forever with you. Because guess what? He made you. He made you, and he loves you. And the incredible depth of love that God has for you is unspeakable. See, because when you were in the midst of an awful lifestyle, God sent his son to die for you. And you guys, I love you guys. There is no way I'm giving up one of my kids for you. It's not going to happen. It's just not going to happen. But God said, before you fixed yourself, before you started to straighten up, while you were in the midst of doing the worst things that you've ever done, God knew those things were going to happen, and he let his son die in your place in the midst of your nastiness. And he did that because of his incredible love for you, so that you could escape hell. And the choice is yours. The choice is yours. And that's what this whole message comes down to. You know, a loving God doesn't send people to hell. People choose when they choose to reject him. But that's a choice that you need to make. If you've never accepted Christ as your Savior, if you've never put him in charge of your life, that's a decision that you need to make. And you need to make that decision soon. Because this world is so crazy right now, you don't know that you're going to be here tomorrow. You just don't know. And so why risk it? Why say, you know what? I think I'm going to follow God. And I think I'm going to follow him 3 weeks from next year. That's why I'm going to make that choice. You don't know if you're going to be here 3 hours from now, let alone 3 weeks from next year. And so make that choice to follow him. That's a decision that you have to make. And if you don't know how to do that, talk to me or talk to one of our staff or talk to whoever brought you. But you need to be serious about that conversation today. If you've already made that decision, if you've already made that choice to follow God and you put him in charge of your life, doesn't mean you're perfect. Doesn't mean you don't continue to sin, but it means that every time that you do, you feel bad about it and you want to keep directing your life back to him. If you're that person already, it's great. It's great what you're doing, but don't forget that you have family, that you have friends, that you have neighbors, that you have coworkers. They need to know God just like you do. Because right now, if they don't know God, they're under his wrath. And our responsibility, our duty, our love for people, it compels us to go and let them know about this Savior. You know, the Christmas season has started, and people are more open to God right now than they are any other time of the year. This is the time that you can hear Jesus proclaimed on the radio. 99.9 has been playing Christmas music for a couple weeks. And some of those songs are saying Jesus. Okay? Any other time of the year, they're not playing Christian songs. There's a whole season here right now where people are the most open to God. And you have an opportunity to be an influence on those people. This story that Jesus tells is a real thing. It's a real thing. And if we really love people, we're going to do the same thing that Jesus did. We're going to sacrifice our desires, our wants, our comfort, our priorities, and we're going to seek to save the lost. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you for the incredible love that you have for us. We thank you for your justice, that the people who do evil, wicked things in this world are going to be punished. But God, we also thank you that for the evil, wicked things that we've done, that you've provided grace. You've provided mercy. And God, I pray that you will help us to choose that. We'll choose that by humbling ourselves, submitting ourselves to your rule, so that we have heaven in the future and we escape hell, yes. Those things are incredible. But also so that we can have a relationship with you right here and right now on this earth. There's nothing better than that. God, thank you for your son. Thank you for your love. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Promise of the cross. Now's the time when we'll take communion. Trays will be passed down the aisle, and you can take a cracker and a cup of juice and pass the tray along to the next person. Justice. Justice, in its most basic, fundamental form, is another word for cause and effect. When someone does something good, there's a reward, and when someone does something bad, there's a punishment. Justice, and true justice, relies on two principles: consistency and severity. In other words, the same bad deed will always net the same punishment, the same good deed will always net the same reward, but there are more severe punishments for more extreme acts. For example, murder has a harsher punishment than theft. We like justice. If you ever doubt that, just look how outraged we get when it's not served, when there's a bad deed with no punishment. God likes justice too, which is why he practices it. And that's a great system, until there's a problem. In this case, the problem is that we've all sinned, and therefore there must be a punishment for that. If God were only a just God, we would all have to serve the punishment for our sins, which is death. But God is a loving God in addition to a just God, and so he sent his son, Jesus, down to serve the punishment for our sins in our place. By doing this, justice is satisfied, and we can continue our relationship with God as if we had never sinned in the first place. And it is to remember this sacrifice each week that we take communion. Let's pray. God, thank you for sacrificing yourself so that we could live with you, even though we do not deserve it. In Jesus' name, amen.
And please stand with us as we close. Our Father, everlasting, all creating one, God Almighty, through your Holy Spirit, Jesus, our Savior.
I believe in God, our Father. I believe in Christ, the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name.
We'll see you about 15 minutes for Engage.